Save through Jordan. thy home above. Thine be the glory, risen, conquering Son. Endless is the victory thou, death, hast won. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like the flood, His mercy rained, unending love, amazing grace. Ladies, please. And all together, my chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like the flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like the flood, His mercy rained, unending love, amazing grace. To God be the glory, to God. To God be the glory. can I say thanks for the things you have done for me, things so undeserved, and yet you gave to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am and ever hope to be, I owe it all to thee. To God be the glory. Let me live my life. Let it be pleasing, Lord, to thee. And if I gain any praise, let it go to Calvary. To God. Will you please be seated? And let us come individually before our Lord, indeed to give him glory, to give him thanks and praise for the sacrifice of his son's death on the cross, that transforming, life-changing sacrifice for each one of us. Father, you have made us the people of Easter. May we never forget your sacrifice for us and for the world, the blood that you shed to save us, and the power with which you have raised us. To you be all glory. Amen. Let us join in our prayer song, Jesus Paid It All.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to claim. I'll wash my garments white in the blood of Calvary's Lamb. Jesus paid it all. Crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat. Paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Come, church, let us go to God in prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you for the reminder that you have paid it all. That even as we gather here, just 1 week after Easter, the memory of you dying on the cross is still fresh in our heads. And not just your death, but Lord Jesus, your resurrection as well. Because you live, you can truly face tomorrow. Lord Jesus, there are many things in this life, there are many things that go on in our lives that we're not sure, we don't know why. But Lord, you give us strength to face tomorrow. Strength that doesn't come from our own, but strength from you. And so Lord, this morning, would you lift those of us who are weary, those of us who are tired, those of us who are about to give up, would you come and assure us? Come and strengthen us. Come and remind us, God, that we do not walk in this journey alone, but Lord, you are with us in every step of the way. And Father, we pray this morning as well, Lord, that as we sit in your house, we remember that we have a Father who loves us so much that he sent his Son to die on the cross for our sins. And church, as I was preparing for this prayer segment, I just sense the Lord impressing upon my heart this sentence that we're very familiar. And I sense that some of us here, we need to hear this. And that is, his mercies are new every morning. God's mercies are new every morning. And every morning, what that means is what every morning we can look to him. Because he is steadfast, he is faithful, and his mercies are truly new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Lord, we thank you that we serve and we worship a faithful God, a God who never gives up, a God who never gives in, and a God who gave up his life for us. So lift our heads, Lord, lift our souls as we face the most difficult of trials. For we know, Lord, with Christ in the vessel, we can smile at the storm. Lord, at this point, we also want to pray for the people in the world whose lives are affected. We want to remember especially the people in Taiwan whose lives are affected because of the earthquake. We remember the families who are still suffering and reeling in from the shock. We want to remember especially those who are trapped and those who have nowhere to go. Father, would you be with them and would you comfort them? Would you assure them, Lord, that all hope is not lost because you are with them? And although, Lord, we may not understand fully the reason why these things have to happen, we know, Lord, that it cannot be that you don't care for us because, Lord, you are with us all the time. And you sent your Son, Jesus, to die and pay the ultimate price. And so, Lord, we stand especially with the people there. We pray, God, for your intervention, for your mercy. We remember also elsewhere, in the elsewhere parts of the world, Lord, where there are people who live in fear, people who live without food, who are malnourished, who are in search of a better life, and what they live in, Lord, is far from ideal. Father, we pray, Lord, that you too would go and comfort them. You will show yourself to be sufficient in every way. And for us here, Lord, help us not to take anything that we have for granted, but move our hands and our feet to love, to care. And Lord, we especially want to pray for the people in our community, in our church, who perhaps on the outside look okay, but within we are struggling as well. Would you help us, move us, Lord, to love those around us, to lend, to extend a hand in love. Because, Lord, we love because you first loved us. And we are simply recipients of your grace and your mercy. And so, Lord, teach us what it means to love. Teach us what it means to care for those around us, Lord. And so we thank you and we look to you. For God, your mercies are new every morning. And truly, as we have sung, Lord, Jesus has paid it all. All to him we owe. And his blood washes us white as snow. We give you thanks. And we pray all this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Good morning, church. Good morning. Just in case you're wondering where the other two pastors are, They didn't skive or, you know, but they are at a pastor's retreat, all right? And so usually every year what happens is after Easter, all the track pastors will go on a retreat and, you know, have a time of break. And so now you're wondering, what am I doing here? Like, did they leave me behind? Well, in some sense, yes. I volunteered to stay behind because I'm on a personal retreat. Okay, actually not really. Like, my wife is in the middle of a confinement and I won't want to leave her, right? So that's why I'm here and I'm just me today. But don't worry. Thank you. You can see the dark rings around my eyes. Barely slept. But anyway, next week they'll be back, okay? So yeah, just look out for that. Okay, so just in case you're wondering where's everyone, okay? Yeah. At this point, I also want to introduce our guest speaker to us. His name is he's Reverend Dr. Philip Huan. I just want to ask him to stand and we can just welcome him. We're really glad he's here with us, and I think he's no stranger. I think he's been here before to speak, and I knew him. I first met him when I was a youth in my home church, so it's been some time, yeah. Anyways, I just want to bring to us a couple of announcements, and so if you have your bulletin, you can just follow along with me. We just have one announcement to highlight, and that's the men's ministry on item number 3. We want to let you know that in 2 Saturdays from now, on the 20th of April, we'll be starting the men's ministry once again after a short hiatus, and the dates are all there. So do lock it in your calendars. And if you do know of someone who is keen to join and be part of this group, please let them know. And if you yourself, you are keen, please do sign up as well. And the details are all over there. We meet on Saturday mornings at 8 a.m. Right behind in this sanctuary, actually, at Aldersgate, level one. All right. And so we just want to let you know that if you want to be a part of this, please do sign up. And there's a QR code for you to do so over there. All right? So those are the announcements for us this morning. At this time, we also want to welcome those of us who are here for the first time, or the first few times. We just want to welcome you and pass you a little package. All right? And that's you. Could you kindly raise your hands? And the ushers will come to you shortly. All right? Just raise your hands. Anyone here for the first time? Yes. Yes, welcome. Welcome. Welcome, my dear brother. Welcome. So glad that you're here. Anyone else that is here for the first time or the first few times? If not, shall we stand, church? Let us stand and let us greet one another and pass the peace of the Lord to each other. Good to see all of us here. At this point, we want to give to God His tithes and offerings. There are 2 ways you can give. You can give electronically. There should be a QR code in front of you in a pew, or if you wish, you can drop the offering at the boxes in the aisles. Shall we go to God in prayer as we give to Him? Let us pray. Almighty God, as we give to You, we remember that we give to a God who is sovereign, a God who is in control. And so, Lord, as we give to You, would You use these gifts for the extension of Your kingdom and Your glory? This we ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Come, church, let us give to the Lord. Church, shall we stand? And let us sing the doxology together.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Now please be seated. I'd like to invite Pastor Philip to come and give the message for us this morning.
Hi, good morning, church. It's really a joy to be able to be here and to see you again. I want to thank Pastor for his kind invitation for me to share God's word with us. So it's really great to be here. I hope the pastors are having a great time over there in Malacca, and that you know that they really have that time of refreshment and encouragement, which I believe they need very much. I want to invite you to open your Bibles with me today to Acts chapter 6. I believe you are in a study, a journey through the book of Acts. Yeah, and we're going to focus on Acts chapter 6 today, and we're going to reference parts of the text through our time today together. So keep your finger on Acts 6, whether it's the Bible on your handphone, tablet, or even the paper Bible that you have. Okay, and I just want to read to us a portion of the text before I actually jump into the message. And I'll read to us from Acts chapter 6, verse 1 to 7, all right? And that's where I just want to focus our attention as we go through our time today. Okay, Acts chapter 6, verse 1, and I'm praying that God will really speak to us as a church and encourage us and minister to us as well. So Acts chapter 6, verse 1, are you there? Yes, if you're there, look up, give me a smile. Okay, you all look good, huh, when you smile, wow. All right, Acts chapter 6, verse 1. In those days when the number of disciples were increasing, the Grecian Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. So the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, "It would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the Word of God in order to wait on tables. Brothers, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom, and we will turn this responsibility over to them and will give our attention to prayer and the ministry of the Word." And this proposal pleased the whole group. They chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, also Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas from Antioch, a convert to Judaism. They presented these men to the apostles, who prayed and laid their hands on them, and so the word of God spread. The number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith. I just want us to focus on that last verse that said these words, "So the word of God spread, and the number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith." Isn't this a picture of a growing church? You know, the gospel was preached, spread widely, the number of disciples increased, disciples referring to people who committed to walking in the ways of Jesus, and these disciples increased rapidly. You know, sometimes you watch those movies where they have those action scenes, right? And there's this huge explosion of some kind, you know, a mushroom of yellow flames, you know, when something explodes, you know. Have you ever seen those kind of scenes? Right? Quite common, right? And those kind of action scenes where there's a huge tsunami, a wall of water comes crashing, and on a small boat of people, this violent, vehement pushing out, as it were, is what this word growing rapidly means in the Greek biblical language of the New Testament. That the disciples, number of disciples grew rapidly. The number of people committing to the ways of Jesus pushed out. It blew up, you know, like that mushroom explosion, like a tsunami wave, vehemently, almost violently, it grew up. You know, when I was visiting Israel with my family, I saw people there who were like priests and teachers of the Word of God, and they were so respected by the culture of the people there that they actually paid by the government to study the Torah. So, you know, even in modern-day Israel, they would be, you'll find people sitting on the streets just reading the Torah, and people would put Israeli shekels, you know, to them to sponsor their studies for the Word of God. Similarly, the priests, even in Jesus' time, were a privileged group. They were honored, they were respected. If suddenly one of them turned to Jesus Christ as their Messiah, for the most part, that priest would have been perceived as leaving Judaism. They would have lost many of these privileges. But here in Acts 6, the Bible tells us a large number of priests, people who would usually resist this kind of Yeshua messianic movement, people who may lose their previous livelihoods and privileges if they have been perceived to leave Judaism or leave their traditional ways, these Jewish priests, a large number of them, came to faith in Christ Jesus. Wow, wasn't this a growing, vibrant church? Amen? How many of you would like to see this kind of mushroom explosion of disciples in Pentecost Methodist Church? Wouldn't it be a great thing to see this kind of thing happen in the church? So, when we look at verse 7, that first word there, so the word of God spread. And you know, with this word so, it tells us that this was the outcome. This was the result. But it was a result of what? What was happening just before that the Bible uses this connector? And so the word of God spread. What caused this church to grow to this extent, to experience this explosion and outward pushing in disciple making? Interestingly, when we look back to the beginning of chapter 6 of Acts, we find that it began with a problem. It began with a problem. And I want to say to you today, even in our walk with God today, when there comes a problem that we face, if we will be discerning and sensitive to the Holy Spirit, it can lead to open doors where God works. And so this explosion of growth that we see began actually with a problem. So let's look at what the problem is. Chapter 6, verse 1 in your Bibles. Keep your finger there, follow with me. Chapter 6, verse 1. Tells us the problem. In those days, when the number of disciples was increasing, the Grecian Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution. Now, the Grecian Jews in Acts 6 were people who had lived in the surrounding lands but had returned to Israel because of their past Jewish lineage. The Grecian Jews would probably have lived most of their lives in the surrounding Palestinian lands, or maybe even further away. They spoke the language of their own lands. They lived the culture of their own lands. And you can imagine that when the religious Jews, they lived within Jerusalem all their lives, they would have looked upon these outsiders with contempt or think that they are second-class citizens of Israel. Because although we were all Jews, the way they behaved were different. Their primary language was different. So between the Jews living in Israel and the Grecian Jews who were living in the surrounding Palestinian lands, there were likely cultural tensions, likely class citizenry discriminations. Now multiply that 1,000 times and you may see what you see between the Jews and the Palestinians today. Today, if you had visited Israel even before the Hamas war, you only had to see the dynamics between the Jews and the Palestinians from the surrounding culture in that same place to know that there is animosity. When we were visiting Israel earlier, we were driving down the highway and we noticed that there was a fence that blocked off the entire landscape from one end of the country all the way down. And we were driving, and that fence ran all the way through almost the entire country. It blocked off the West Bank. And we were told that even though we rented the car, you can't drive the car into that area. You can't drive into any of these marked out territories, you know, which were largely, hugely Palestinian occupied. Now go back to 1st century AD, where the Jewish believers and the believers from the surrounding Palestinian lands came together in one place because of the power and the work of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It brought these two groups of people together. And now, emotions were boiling over. The Gresham Jewish widows, you know, perceived that the Hebraic Jews were getting better distributions, and complaints were rife in that church. Complaints that sometimes we may even hear, you know, in our own church and ministries today. Why are the resources not better used? Why this leader cannot lead better? Why is this ministry doing such a poor job? Why is one group of people getting more benefits than the others neglected? I wonder if you've ever heard complaints like that, even in your own ministry today. And the situation in Acts chapter 6 could become a big problem. You following me? It would become a big problem. But though the problem was there, the focus was critical. Surprisingly, the apostles' focus was not on the problem alone. You know, usually when we have a problem, we focus on the problem, we find solutions, we find scenario A, scenario B, we nail it, you know, until we pray it through, pray against spiritual warfare until the problem collapses. You know, that's what we usually do. But in addressing the problem, the apostles were not focused on the problem alone. Look at me at chapter 6, verse 2. Verse 2, it says this: "So the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, 'It would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the Word of God in order to wait on tables.'" See, the focus that they had was on God's calling and purpose. The ministry of prayer and the Word could not be neglected. It would not be right to take away people from the ministry of the Word to do something else, even if it was to solve a pretty serious people problem. Now, the church grows when her resources and organization are aligned to her God-called vision and mission. You know, when problems in the church drive people to rethink how we are doing in our mission and calling and to navigate it, to improve it, that's when the church becomes healthy and grows. And I want to share a thought with you today. The church grows when problems do not distract, but rather become stepping stones that stretch her to fulfill Christ's mandate even better. And this is something for us as a church to pay attention to. Peter Drucker, an expert management guru, himself became a Christian in his later years, once said that every leader must ask these questions. What is our main business, and how is business? What do you think is the main business of Pentecost Methodist Church? What do you think it is? Turn to someone, take 15, 20 seconds, okay? Just tell each other what you think the main business of Pentecost Methodist Church is. Go quickly, quickly, quickly. 15, 20 seconds. Just very quickly turn. No right, no wrong answer, okay? Please relax. No pressure, no pressure. Okay, just turn. All right. Come. Yeah. People at the back, come on. No, turn. Tell what main business. Yeah, in church, right? Many years. What's the main business of church? Wow. No one ever asked me that before. Come. Okay, you know, when we look into the chapter, Acts chapter 6, it describes a solution, right? We talk about a solution to a problem. The solution was so powerful because it was implemented and the outcome was this. So the word of God spread. The number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith. What was this specific solution? That's what we want to look at today. What kept the church focused on her main business despite the fact that there are many people problems around? Okay? What led to this explosion of discipleship growth? We find that the solution in Acts 6 was problem-oriented, but it was core mission-focused. And it encouraged various groups of people to agree and to buy in, to all play their part. It was a solution that was it engaged the problem, but it was focused on the mission, and it had the buy-in and support of all the people. And that is why I want to let you know that all of us play our part in helping Pentecost Methodist Church to be a growing, healthy church. I pray that as you, the community here, agree, buy in, support one another, and play your part, it could lead to that vibrant and explosive disciple-making call of the Lord Jesus Christ upon Pentecost. So we want to look at the solution in Acts 6 today to see what they actually did that helped that church grow explosively, and ask the Lord to begin to do the same in our hearts and in our church as well, all right? So let's pause here for a word of prayer. Let's ask the Lord to really do this deeply in us. Let's pray. Father, we want to thank you for a brand new day. Thank you for the word that is shared, that your mercies are new every morning. Such a ministering word. And Lord, we look to you, we cast our eyes on you, and we ask for a fresh start, outpouring of your Holy Spirit on us today. Lord, we want to ask that what we look into your word today, you will speak to us, you will speak to our leaders, you speak to us as members, or to us as staff and pastors, and that, Lord, you would open our heart to your heart in this word. And you would really help our church to be a spirit-filled, anointed, empowered, that Pentecost Methodist Church would be like that church in that early days, that experienced the work of the Holy Spirit in touching people and seeing the explosion of lives that were changed by the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. So bless us, help us to walk with you in this. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. This morning, I want to share with us several keys to the solution that was in Acts 6 that kept the church on a growth trajectory. Okay, and I want to be able to guide us through this. What helps us to keep growing? Firstly, let's begin with mission. Okay, a church is healthy when leaders reorganize to keep focus on preaching the gospel and making disciples. Okay, leaders reorganize to keep focus on preaching the gospel and making disciples. Look with me at verse 2, okay, of chapter 6. Verse 2 says this: "So the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, 'It would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the word of God in order to wait on tables.' The apostles said, 'It would not be right to neglect the ministry of what Jesus had commanded them to do.'" This phrase, "not to neglect," means it's not desirable. Okay, it's not right to neglect it. Okay, it's not proper. It's not right. You know, I once remember I was driving. My wife, Jenny, was sitting on the passenger seat. And she said, "Honey, the sunlight looks so beautiful. The rays shining through the clouds looks like it's God shining down on heaven. Would you take a look?" I said, "Dear, I can't take a look. I need to keep my eyes on the road, or else we'll really end up in heaven." Okay, what I meant, okay, was that if I let my focus on the road move to the periphery, I could crash the car, right? So to neglect here means to do that. That main road that was in front suddenly got pushed to the periphery because of something else. Something that happened made what was supposed to be in front of you move to one side. Friends, the church cannot let the preaching of the gospel and making disciples, which was supposed to be the main business, become a side business. It cannot become one of the many businesses. It cannot be, you know, a side business of the church. The leaders must keep it in the front view at all times as the main business. You following me? And that's what leaders must do. You cannot imagine how important the apostles actually viewed this. You know, prior to this, in chapter 5 of Acts, it tells us that there were several things that could have made preaching the gospel and making disciples become relegated away. to the side business. The first thing that happened was authorities put them in the public jail, chapter 5, verse 17. And the Bible tells us an angel released them in order to continue their main business. Another thing that happened, religious communities and leaders questioned and opposed them. Faced by the authorities and the vast historical knowledge and pressure influence of the religious leaders, they could have been intimidated, you know, from their main business. Further, they were physically abused and beaten. They could have been physically cowered into backtracking, as it were, from that main business. And now, in Acts 6, internal needs and lack of resources could threaten to make them feel guilty, make them feel so busy meeting many needs that they would have neglected their main business. Are there dangers of these things happening in Pentecost Methodist Church today? Are any of these things happening that could make your leaders and pastors step back, backtrack, the main business somehow become relegated to become that side business? And it caused a neglect of what God has put on the heart of the church. So in Acts 5 and 6, you see this list of possible things that could have derailed them from their main business. The message through all this was this: delay the gospel and teaching, put it on a shelf, because there are more immediate pressing concerns. That's what this message presses on us. But in Acts 6, the healthy church solution was instead to reorganize. They reorganize in order to focus on gospel preaching and teaching. They kept focus. Can everyone say after me, keep focus? One more time, keep focus. They reorganize in order to keep focus on the church's gospel preaching and teaching, the given mandate of Jesus Christ. Friends and members, are you playing your part to encourage the leaders of the church to focus on gospel outreach and teaching? Are you encouraging your leaders? Or are we sometimes, you know, the one that is causing some of these difficulties? Causing these problems that may, we don't mean it, but inadvertently it results in intimidation. It results in backtracking or a distraction that it neglects the church's main mandate. Are you saying to your pastors and your LCEC, your board members, to tell them, I'm praying for you. I'm praying for you to courageously lead the church in her main business. What can I do to help you focus on the main calling of Pentecost Methodist Church and to do it well? What role can you play as a member and friend of Pentecost Methodist Church in this? Which leads me to the second key to Acts 6 solution. The second thought I want to share with you: the church grows when new and younger people willingly rise up to be servant leaders for ministry. The church grows when new and younger people willingly rise up to be servant leaders for ministry. Look with me at verse 3, okay? Verse 3 in your Bibles. Brothers, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom, and we will turn this responsibility over to them. You see, what helped the church remain healthy and mission-focused was the raising of another generation of servant leaders. I remember I was consulting for a church, and I run a ministry that consults for the health of and growth of churches and NGOs. And I remember consulting for a church who wanted to raise a new generation of elders board members, elders council board members. They looked one generation down, and they could not find anyone available and mature enough. They looked 2 generations down from the elders generation, and they still could not find any. Finally, they looked 3 generations down, and they could find a few of them that were committed and growing into maturity. But these people were young adults, they were youth, they were a long distance, you know, from what traditionally the elder status and maturity and age would be. They had to be intentionally recruited and mentored while they were still young to become future potential board and LCEC members. You know, in a number of churches that I consult, this problem that these churches face is a common one. And it's common because of this. The Gen X, okay, those in your 40s and 50s, where they are, we are too busy. These people are now the senior managers, CEOs, head of departments in church. They are so busy, they are stretched. It's difficult to find committed leaders at their levels. Understandable. The upper Gen Y, 30s to 40s, okay? Gen Y, they are just easing into executive management roles in the marketplace. They have young children. This is the time. They're coping with kids' education, expenses, and care. So, pastor is moving into that category. You know, and they're often burdened with many, many things. They are tired. You see dark rings around the eye, you see your pastor, now you understand, right? Okay, but it's quite common, you know, in the age group, they're juggling so many things. But the truth of the matter is this, until the Gen X and the Gen Y and even younger are willing to rise up as servants for the Lord Jesus Christ, the church will not be able to meet church-wide needs as well as focus on mission-critical matters. Choose men from among you who are full of the Spirit and wisdom. We will turn this responsibility over to them and give our attention to prayer and ministry of the Word. Friends, your pastors cannot do this on their own. Your board and LCEC leaders cannot do this on their own. It needs a new generation of people to rise up and be willing to serve. Now, of the seven people that were selected by the apostles then, not all of them were necessarily younger. We know that they could have been younger. They could have been definitely younger in spiritual maturity. Not necessarily all. But the fact remains is that they were a new generation. And some of them were probably younger. They were the next generation. A group of new and next spiritual generation was willing to rise up. Now, that made the difference. So, in this key to church growth, I want to speak to those of us here who are in your 50s. 50s. Where are you? In your hands? Hands? 50s? Raise your hands. Don't be shy. Come on. 50s. Come on. 50s. Yes. Come on. Come on. More. More. Come on. Come on. Okay. Then those in your 40s. 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 Okay. Number 40s. All right. Okay. Those on top also, if you participate, you know, it's not just for... Okay. And especially, I want to speak to those in your 30s and 20s. Come on. 30s and 20s. Where are you? 30s and 20s. 30s and 20s. Come on. Okay. All right. Okay. I want to ask you, do you want to see your church healthy and growing? Amen? Okay. Then I want to share with you some applications. For that to happen, a next generation of servant leaders must rise up. And they rise up by doing these few things. Firstly, they choose godly priorities in life. There are so many priorities that we can make. We choose godly priorities in life. Don't try to do everything because we will get burnt out. Okay? They must not get distracted by worldly things. All the world, your friends, people in offices, all this, your executives, your CEO, all they have got many voices that come against you. You must not get distracted by worldly things. Let godly elders and spiritual leaders, senior leaders of the church, guide you and mentor you. Look to those who have walked the path and say, these are great examples. I want to find someone to mentor me to grow in the things of God. Now, conversely, there are some mental blocks that will prevent this. Mental blocks that will prevent millennials and even Gen X from rising up to be committed servants for Christ. Mental blocks such as this thought. I'm tired of so many things, I just want my own thing. That's a common thinking in our world today, you know, that blocks what God wants to do. I want to change the world, but on my own with my friends. You know? This is also, interestingly, on the increase. People want to change the world, but they want to do their own way. They want to do only with their generation, with their friends and their own style. And the thought, older people don't understand me, they're not relevant to me. These are common mental blocks that prevent God from working to raise that next generation. These are the mental thoughts that even pre-believing young people think today. This is what our worldly friends are thinking. And if we also, as believers, think this way, how different are we from the pre-believers? You are God's chosen people. God wants you to be special and different. God wants an intergenerational community that sees younger people rise up to serve both the young and the old to help the church focus on fulfilling a mission. Look, young people, do you just want to be young? Or do you want to be a God-anointed young? You know, which do you want? Do you just want to be young? Or do you want to be forever young? Turn to someone next to you and tell them the answer. Go, quickly. So, see, that's the difference. That's the willingness that makes Pentecost Methodist Church healthy and growing. Let me share a conversation I've heard several times in my pastoral experience. You know? So, Pastor alluded to the fact that we met a long, long, long time ago. And he was probably a youth at the time. Yeah, at the time, a young person once in their and it need not be young. Even people in their 40s and 50s think this way. Okay, they are challenged to serve full time, or consider a pastoral ministry or something like that. You know, and they say to me, Pastor, I cannot. I'm not spiritual enough. No, go and ask Pastor Isaac over there. You know, see, he's a pastor, he's gifted, he's passionate for God. Ask him, don't ask me, I'm not spiritual enough. But the truth is, I've known many people like the pastors that they refer to. You know, they don't just become a pastor, you know. They didn't just one day, well, I feel called by God, I'm going to be a pastor. It doesn't happen that way. They just wanted to walk close to God. They wanted to obey God step by step. Over time, over decision in life, they obey the Lord, they walk in the Lord. And as they continue to walk in the Lord, they grew to that maturity. They grew to become a pastor, of a person of pastor quality. You know what I'm trying to say? Yeah? So my point is this. People, there are no such thing as pastor quality people. All pastor quality people that you see today are people who just took step by step. I just want to follow God. I want to obey God. I want to walk with God. And they commit their decisions to the Lord. And over time, they grow into the standing and character of what we'll call a pastor quality person. Sometime back, I spoke to a very senior Sunday school teacher in his 60s now. He shared about one of his Sunday school students that when the student was very young, in Sec 1, he served in the worship team. Okay? And he was playing very quick, meekly and quietly on the keyboard. Not like Angie here. Angie is a fantastic pianist, isn't she? Yeah, just so wowed by. You know, I've known Angie for, I won't say how many years, but we grew up in youth together, and she was, in fact, a great pianist, even then, musician, you know. And even all of them, we were wowed by her. We were wondering who would end up marrying her. What a great... Get a good catch. Okay, that's all I can say from those back. You know, yeah. Okay, so this young guy in Sec 1 was playing meekly on the keyboard. This Sunday school teacher observed him, and he grew. You see, as he went along Sec 2, Sec 3, he began to make choices, follow the Lord. By Sec 4, you know, he was leading worship on the keyboard. The keyboard was up in front. He was one hand playing, one hand, everyone! You know, like Don Moen, you know, he said like that. You know, just playing and leading. And he saw him grow, you know, and it was very interesting. This person is now a senior pastor, okay, in a church. And I met with him recently, and he said, to me, Pastor Philip, on one occasion when I was much younger, when you were leading worship in a revival meeting, I felt God speak to me to go full-time. I was scared out of my wits. You know, I went to Australia to study instead. and when he was there, he said, I found a girlfriend, I was offered a role as a worship pastor in an Australian church. But I was troubled because I felt God say, my calling is for you to come back to Singapore and enter Bible College here. So I was very troubled about this. I asked that Australian church, give me 1 month to pray about it. And in that 1 month, he came back to Singapore and he sought counsel with his pastors in Singapore. They recommended him to a Bible college and it opened a door for him. It was like in the middle of a weird term, no, not at registry. He just entered and the door opened for him. And he said, I took it as a sign from God. And this young man said, with a burdened heart, I went back to Australia. I declined that worship pastor invitation, I took some time to amicably settle my affairs and mutually separate from my then girlfriend, you know, and return to Singapore to enter Bible College. To cut a long story short, this not so young man now, okay, sitting with me in Starbucks sharing his story, he's now a senior pastor for 2 years, happily married with 2 children. You see, what I'm trying to say is this: you don't have pastor quality people who become pastors. What you have are people who just say you want to grow in God. They hear and obey God step by step in their jobs, in their relationships, in their decisions. When God speaks to them, they want to obey Him. And then they grow over many years to become that caliber of pastor quality. You following me? And when that happens, some may be called to become pastors. Some may not be called to become pastors. But I know that wherever God puts them as pastor quality people, they will serve God with anointing where God has placed them. Amen? You are as much pastor quality where you are right now. If you decide to be hungry for God today, obey Him in what He says. Now, God may or may not call you to be a pastor. That's even secondary. But you don't become of pastor quality. Rather, you grow into being of pastor quality little by little through your everyday walk with God. How I wish Pentecost Methodist Church had many people of pastor quality. Don't you wish that? That there'll be many people here of pastor quality. Now, some God may call them to full-time, some God may not call them to full-time, but wherever they are, they will serve with anointing. You following me? And that is the prayer we want. You must understand that in Acts 6, there were no titles yet, like pastor so-and-so. There was not even a title deacon so-and-so, you know. The word diaconate was used in Acts 6 only as a verb, as a function. They came to serve the tables. That's what that verb actually means. It only described the function they were doing. Only much later in Christian history, in 1 Timothy, that Paul began to use the word as a deacon, as a title. I'm trying to say to you, you don't need the title of a leader or a pastor. You don't need to have this title, I'm a pastor so-and-so, you know, I'm a LCEC member so-and-so. You don't need these things. You can be anointed where you are and serve with the quality and standing of a pastor. Amen? And so it's time to ask ourselves, can we grow to function in the anointing? And you can if you desire. That's why Pentecost Methodist Church must intentionally build the environment for this younger and next generation to rise up. Which leads me to a third trait of growing churches. Older leaders intentionally prepare for new leader selection and growth. Older leaders intentionally prepare for new leader selection and growth. How am I doing on time? How much time? Still okay? All right. Just prompt me, okay? So look at me at verse 5 and 6, okay? 5 and 6 in your Bibles. This proposal pleased the whole group. They chose Stephen, a man full of faith and the Spirit, also Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas from Antioch, a convert to Judaism, and presented these men to the apostles who prayed and laid their hands on them. This proposal pleased the whole group. Now, this phrase, the whole group, could have been the 12 apostles, or it could have been the entire core, 120 disciples with Jesus Christ previously. Bible scholars acknowledge that it could refer to either. They are possible. This means that possibly an entire core of the early church got involved in this process, agreeing, buying into the support of developing the next generation leaders. And this, the Bible says they chose seven. The word chose here represents a very deliberate selection. It was not just something in general. It was a word that said there was intention, there was planning behind it. Maybe they visited them, they talked with them, they prepared them to in order to filter and find these seven people. And they presented to the apostles. The root word in this word present means to give witness. This core of the early church went around collating. They said, who are the ones who could be nominated? What are their qualities? What are we looking for? And then they begin to give witness. Where did you observe them? What are the traits they have? The way they carry themselves? Do you think they're mature? They did all these things. Do they meet the criteria? They had at least some kind of selection that involves witness and observation of their track record. You know, I've been privileged to mentor some young adults who want to serve God in ministry. One of them has over time become a part-time staff in her church in strategic planning. She volunteers in the young adult ministry herself, and she runs her own corporate consultancy. Another one is a medical doctor, a specialist pediatrician. He is hoping to sign up for a pastoral internship in his church. He wants to be a preacher and a missionary. Another one that I mentored has become a senior pastor already, quite young, okay, senior pastor for the last few years. And as a senior pastor, a young senior pastor, he once lamented to me, "Pastor Philip, it's so difficult to lead a wide range of generations of people. I want to lead the church in a new way that would really draw the younger generation to bring their friends, but I'm not sure how the older generation will think of it and whether the older generation will support it. I'm not sure what to do." Now, these are the serious tensions of younger leaders that rise up who want to serve the church. A well-known senior pastor in Singapore who inherited that role from his father actually once broke down and shared about mental illness and depression when he took on leadership as a younger leader. He had members who left the church because they just could not accept him as a leader. Friends, our young people and young potentials, as they rise up, they need mentors. They need encouragers from the older generation. They need older generations, you know, to like us, to come around them, and they won't say, "This person is so young, I cannot see him as my pastor, no. You know, I can see this older, more distinguished person as pastor. This is too young, I cannot see him as my pastor." They won't say that, but rather they will say, "I will stand with this young man or this young woman, I will champion for them. I want to see them succeed in maturity and their gifts to blossom in these things even more than I did at their age." Amen? This is the mark of a healthy, growing church. In Acts 6, an entire core of disciples bought into this process, committed themselves to it to raise a new and next generation of leaders. And ultimately, it led to great change, because a church grows when members aspire towards fruitfulness through changed lives. When members aspire towards fruitfulness through changed lives. Look at me at verse 7. Can I read to us from verse 7 to 10? "So the word of God spread, and the number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith. Not only did the church remain missional, we see this, but a number of these new generation leaders also rose to apostle quality." Look at me at verse 8. "Now Stephen, a man full of God's grace and power, did great wonders and miraculous signs among the people. Opposition arose, however, from the members of the synagogue of the freemen, as it was called, and Jews of Cyrene and Alexandria, as well as the provinces of Sicilia and Asia. These men began to argue with Stephen, but they could not stand up against his wisdom or the spirit by which he spoke." See, Stephen was one of the seven chosen. You see, because a core of disciples, okay, a core, not just a few, not just the LC, a core of disciples came and invested in helping a new generation of leaders, it led to that next generation of leaders becoming anointed powerfully. Their lives were changed. They impacted the lives of other people. Stephen is just the first example. Philip was another example of the seven, who later in Acts 8 did miracles and signs and evangelized to the Ethiopian eunuch. Now, all these seven servants had Greek names. They were probably the believers from the surrounding Palestinian and outer region areas. They may even have been some of the Grecian Jews who were initially looked down upon by the Hebraic Jews. Friends, how do you measure if Pentecost Methodist Church is healthy? How do you know if your church is doing well? It's not just by programs and services. It's not just by whether you like the pastor, you feel it's appealing or not, or the children ministry is great. Rather, it's by seeing more people touched by God. Lives that are changed. People you never thought possible grow in maturity, rise to serve Christ with impact and sacrifice. You know, Haddon Robinson is a renowned expository preacher. His books on preaching are textbooks in seminaries. I use them in the Bible College classes myself when I do a lesson or coach on preaching. You know, and he is quite renowned and well-known. written a number of books. And I had the privilege to listen to him one season when I was in the US. And Robinson shared that when he came to Christ as a teenager, when he came to faith, his non-Christian friends in his basketball team all could immediately see the difference in his life, the changes in his life. Then he went to visit a church. And in that church, those people in the church could not see any change. They thought that Robinson was a very rough kid from the neighborhood, you know, very unbecoming in his behavior. Robinson said that if behavior was a thermometer, if it was a thermometer of range, zero to how high, he said that his behavior started from zero when he became Christ. And by grace, he grew to 5, to 10, to 15. You know, but the people in those church, they came from great middle-class backgrounds, family backgrounds. Their behavior were like 40 or 50. And this way, when they look at this guy here, behavior 5, 10, God. And Robinson said that, you know, they didn't even need to try, they hit 40 and 50 because their parents and their family background put so much into them. And they look at Robinson and they said, this guy is probably not safe. So in fact, the church people kept praying for Robinson's salvation for years, even after he had received Christ. They also pray for him to receive Christ. Then Robinson said something that struck me. He said, you can be a plus 5 in Christian behavior, but if you have grown from a minus 5 to move to plus 5, that is growth. You following me? However, if you born into a family already, plus 50, you go to church, you stay plus 50, after 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, you are still at plus 50, that is zero growth. You following me? See, it's not measured by just things on the outside. It's measured by changed lives. Robinson said, some people rely on their middle-class upbringing and what their parents put into them, but they are not growing disciples of Jesus Christ. So what is a healthy church? I want to encourage the leaders here to focus on what is right. I want to encourage my leaders in Pentecost Methodist Church to focus on outreach and growing disciples, to focus on the main business. I want to grow to become of pastor quality in my faith, to serve God with anointing. I want to help mentor and encourage and support new generations of people to rise up. I want to see new people come to church, more lives touched and changed by God in Pentecost Methodist Church. Because a growing church begins with me. So the word of God spread, and the number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith. Will you play your part to make Pentecost Methodist Church a growing church? I want to invite us to put our things down. Let's stand to our feet. And let's respond to the Lord in prayer. Holy Spirit, just come right now. I pray you will convict us. So many things in the world and wrap around us and shroud around us. But Lord, here is the stirring of the Holy Spirit in Pentecost Methodist Church that wakes us up and says, there is more than this. We want to see a new generation rise up. We want to see leaders focus on their God-called purpose. I want to play my part. I will not just become a person of pastor quality. I want to grow into it. I want to follow the Lord. And where He places me, I will serve with anointing. Father, let your Holy Spirit burn this into our hearts today. Turn us to your ways. Help us to make that difference, Lord. Hallelujah. Let's sing this song. Let's worship the Lord. Thank you. Won't you, Lord, take a look at our hands? Everything we have, use it for your plan. Won't you, Lord, take a look at our hearts? Mold it, refine it, as you set us apart. We want to run to the altar, catch the fire, to stand in the gap between the living and the dead. Give us a heart of compassion for a world without vision. We will make a difference, bringing hope to our land. Let's sing that again. Won't you, Lord? Won't you, Lord, take a look at our hands? Everything we have, use it for your plan. Won't you, Lord, take a look at our hearts? Mold it, refine it, as you set us apart. We want to run to the altar, catch the fire, to stand in the gap between the living and the dead. Give us a heart of compassion for a world without vision. We will make a difference, bringing hope. We want to run. We want to run to the altar and catch the fire, to stand in the gap between the living and the dead. Give us a heart of compassion for a world without vision. We will make a difference, bringing hope to our land. I want to invite us, as the musician continues to minister to us a bit quietly, and then I want to invite us, you know, to ask ourselves, what is a healthy and growing church? The answer really is in your hands. If you all play a part, as the disciples agreed and worked together, I believe God will do great things in Pentecost Methodist Church. And I want to challenge those of you in your teens, in your 20s, in your 30s, in your 40s, if you want to grow to be a person of pastor quality, to be anointed in serving God, you know, I just want to challenge you to say, yes, God, this is what I want. I want to grow. I don't just suddenly become, but I want to make every step, every decision that I make, honor you and grow in the ways that you desire for me. And if you're saying, you know, Pastor Philip, today I want to be like that pastor quality, whether God calls me full-time or not, that's even secondary, but I want to be of that pastoral anointing where God has put me, to grow into that maturity. Pastor, will you pray for me? And I want to pray for you. I want to pray for you if that is your heart. I want to ask for the Lord to bless you. Those of you who are 40s, 50s, 60s, and 70s. If you are saying, you know, I want to make my life count, I want to encourage the younger, I want to champion them, I want to help them be more anointed, more empowered than I even was at my age, I want to bless them. Show me how, oh Lord. And if that's the prayer of your heart, I want to pray for you too. I want to pray that God will anoint you and watch over you. So I just want to give us an opportunity to respond to the Lord. Two groups of people. If you're saying, Pastor, I want to grow to become a person of pastor quality, anoint me day by day, I want to invite you to respond. If you're saying, Pastor, I want to make my life count, I'm in an older age now, I want to be very anointed and intentional in bringing up the next generation, encouraging them, championing them, to see them become even better than even my generation was. Pastor, would you pray for me? If you belong to either of these groups and you're saying, yes, Pastor, yes, I want to ask you to lift your hands right now. Would you do that? Just bow our heads, close our eyes, just for a moment, just reverence the Lord. Just lift your hands. If you're saying, Pastor, I'm young, I don't know everything, but I want to grow to be a person of pastor quality. Pastor, I want to see the younger people. I've not connected with them very well, but I want to have a heart for them. I want to encourage them to grow, to be the next generation leaders. If this is your prayer, just lift up your hands wherever you are. Would you do that? Just hold up your hands. Hold it up high, not right now. I want to be able to see it. I want the Lord to be able to see it. Just hold it up high. Hallelujah. Father, I want to pray for these people whose hands are lifted to you, both here, both standing up in the atrium. Lord, all this, Lord, I want to pray for these people. Let your anointing come upon them. Pour forth your Holy Spirit. Bless them, Lord. I want to pray for this intergenerational anointing to come that we saw in Acts 6, that the older would select and draw out the younger, empower them until they grew to be of apostle quality. Father, this helped the church to explode in its growth, to focus on its mission, and yet to serve all the needs of the people groups that were within. Father, let your anointing come, let your Holy Spirit come. So Lord, for these people who are saying, Pastor, I really want to grow into pastoral quality. Let your anointing come upon them. Lord, you have given me a heart for these people. Let the anointing that you have flowed through me in my life to come upon them. You will stir their hearts. You will give them visions and dreams. You will bring brothers and sisters older into their lives that will encourage and guide them. There will be open doors, open opportunities they could never have imagined. So Lord, I pray for this anointing. You have given a passion in my life, all this that will flow through me into them. You will touch them. You will minister to them, and they will come to walk close to you. They will desire you every step of the way through their business decisions, their marketplace, their family decisions, their personal decisions. They will walk in the ways of the Lord, and you will put your destiny upon them as you desire. Father, you bless them, watch over them. I want to pray for those who are older. God, I pray that they will have a heart of passion for the younger people. They will not say, you know, I can't see them as my pastor, but they will say, I will come beside them. I will encourage them. I will lift them up. Lord, I want to sow the seeds into young people. I want to be a model myself. I want to walk right with the Lord. I want to walk close to the Lord and impart into them this blessing. Watch over them, that there will be a mentoring cover and encouragement that will come upon Pentecost Methodist Church, that no young person who wants to walk close to God and rise up to serve will lack a spiritual father or spiritual mother in Pentecost Methodist Church. There will be people here that will see them, will be sensitive. Sometimes they're not even asked. They will pick up the vibes. They will know. They will take a step and initiate towards the younger. Father, you bless them. Watch over them. Hallelujah. Lord, bless our church. Let your anointing grow in Pentecost. Lord, we just want to ask that you will help this church really mushroom, blow up violently to be disciple makers. Lord, we just want to commit them to you. Help us to make that difference. We want to run to the altar and catch the fire, to stand in the gap between the living and the dead. Give us a heart of compassion for a world without vision. We will make a difference, bringing hope. We want to run. We want to run to the altar, catch the fire, to stand in the gap between the living and the dead. Give us a heart of compassion for a world without vision. We will make a difference, bringing hope to our land.
Truly, Lord, that is our prayer. And we pray, Lord, that even as we come together as a church, as your family, broken as we are, we remember the sacrifice of Christ and his blood and his body that unites us all, Lord, that empowers us beyond ourselves. And even as we come to your table right now, Lord, we remember how Jesus sacrificed everything for us. We give you thanks and pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, church, in a moment's time, we're going to be celebrating the Holy Communion. And so can we ask that you take the elements out? And if you don't have the elements, that's all right. You can just raise your hands and the ushers will come to you shortly. If you're watching online, we also want to invite you to take the elements out. At this point, it's also important to say that these elements have been consecrated as well. So they've been set aside for the use of Holy Communion. Would you join me in a great thanksgiving? The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, if your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join the unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ, offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here. Make these gifts of consecrated bread and wine be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us sing the Lord's Prayer together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Pray. The Holy Communion is a sacrament, and in the sacrament grace is imparted. And so wherever we are, let us come before the Lord and ask Him for whatever grace we need to walk in wholeness, to walk in strength, to walk in the ways of the Lord. And we remember that our Lord was bruised, beaten, scorned, died on the cross. But because of His death, because of His stripes, we are now healed. And so, Lord Jesus, as we hold this wafer in our hands, we remember Your body that was broken for us. And we give You thanks. In Jesus' name. Come, church, let us eat. Let's open up the cup. Lord Jesus, as we drink of this, we remember of Your blood. Your blood that washes us clean. Your blood that was shed for us. May we always remember and not take Your blood for granted. We thank You, Lord, and we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Come, let's drink. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank You from Scripture in Acts chapter 6 that You have called us to be a church without walls, a church without barriers, a church that lifts one another up, a church that intentionally disciples and to make the main business, Lord. And so, Lord, this morning, as You have spoken to our hearts and convicted us, we pray that as we go from here, Lord, we go in Your grace, we go in Your strength, we go in the power of the Holy Spirit. And so, Lord, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, our Heavenly Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and evermore. Amen. Well, church, please be seated. The service is over. And as always, if you do need prayer, please do not be shy to come to the front, and we'll be more than happy to pray with you.